The evolution of complexity is an absolutely fascinating topic, and there have been multiple significant and irreversible jumps in complexity that have happened throughout the history of life, such as going from prokaryote to eukaryote organisms, or from unicellular to multicellular organisms. These are known as major evolutionary transitions, and today, with the help of Professor Jacobus Boomsma, we are going to be talking about how one of the most recent major evolutionary transitions happened, how we went from solitary insects to cooperative superorganisms. For those wondering, a superorganism is a colony of individuals with irreversibly differentiated castes, and a prime example of that would be the honeybee hive. Honeybee colonies actually have three differentiated castes: the drones, whose sole purpose is to mate with the queen who will store the drone sperm for the rest of her life and use it to fertilise her eggs, and the workers, who don't reproduce and whose sole duty is to maintain the nest and feed the queen and the brood to ensure the colony is maintained. Within a superorganism, there is a distinct and irreversible separation between reproductive individuals and those who are sterile. In essence, a superorganism actually lives and reproduces as if it were an entire organism in itself. Superorganisms are actually considered a form of obligate eusociality, and eusociality, which means true sociality, has actually evolved repeatedly within many animals, and basically some animals actually opt out of reproducing in lieu of helping another individual reproduce in its place. Eusocial animals share various key characteristics. They have overlapping generations in which the parents and offspring coexist together, which leads to cooperative brood care and reproductive altruism, which basically means that some individuals do not reproduce in lieu of helping other individuals reproduce more. The transition from facultative eusociality, in which some individuals can switch between castes, for instance, sterile workers could turn into potential reproductive individuals, and obligate eusociality, where such switching is not possible because you're committed to life to the caste you belong to, has believed to have evolved four times: in the higher termites, the vespine wasps, the corbiculate bees, and the ants. However, it has been a bit of a mystery why this evolution would take place in the first place, and Professor Koos Boomsma, who is the director for the Centre of Social Evolution in the University of Copenhagen and recently was a visiting Newton Abrahams professor here at Oxford, is actually the father of the accepted theory of how a superorganism could evolve in the first place.
Well, the idea I've been developing over the last 10 years is that what you need for that is the most strict form of lifetime monogamy that you can imagine. That is a form of monogamy where you only will have one sexual partner in your life, and you will die with that partner.
The idea of lifetime monogamy is extremely important due to the key idea of relatedness. Now, inclusive fitness and relatedness are very important concepts in this video. I have actually made a video and a blog post before on these topics, so if you've never heard of it, I would recommend watching it to get a better understanding. But in short, individuals seek to maximise inclusive fitness. What that means is that an individual doesn't maximise its direct fitness, which would imply that it has as many offspring as possible, but rather that it maximises a combination of having as many offspring as it can, and also helping individuals that share the same genes that they do. So this means that an individual might be more likely to help a relative because they will share genes together at a higher rate than the population average, and that rate is what is known as relatedness. Now, the higher the relatedness between two individuals, the higher the proportion of genes they share as compared to the population average. And in the context of protocolonies, if relatedness is sufficiently high that an individual has the same relatedness to their own offspring as they do to their siblings, the potential for caste evolution begins to arise, as some individuals could opt out of reproducing in order to help a dominant reproductive to produce more offspring.
And that means there is essentially no conflict between the two parents if that happens. And that also means that there will be 100% families that only produce full siblings. And that makes your relatedness between those siblings and their future siblings so high, maximally, invariably high, that it becomes indifferent in relatedness terms whether you breed yourself or whether you actually help your mother producing more brothers and sisters.
Now, how lifetime monogamy is maintained in these protocolonies can actually occur in different ways. For instance, in the Hymenopterans, which are the bees, the wasps, and the ants, what happens is the queen mates a single time with the drone. After mating, the male generally dies, and the queen goes on to found the colony alone. She will then store his sperm for the next 30 years, from which he produces all of the eggs, from which the rest of the colony will arise.
Now, the termites have done it in a totally different way. They're the father of the family, survive. They dig in together. So they have had their dispersal flight, and then they find each other, but rather than mating and the male dying, as happens in the ants, bees, and wasps, here they basically they form a tandem pair and they find a place to begin together. We'll then make a royal cell and mate repeatedly over time, and that will produce the offspring, and the offspring will start doing the foraging and getting the food to the colony, so the colony can grow, can in some of these termites become enormous, just like in some ant colonies. But there, interestingly, the pair will be together throughout their long lives.
Either way, lifetime monogamy is enforced such that the queen mates a single time in her life, and the workers never have the opportunity to mate. The consequence is that the colony's relatedness is maximized. And as long as the relatedness between offspring and siblings is maintained at an exact constant of 0.5 or above, evolution will eventually select for worker sterility. This selection will occur as soon as the fitness benefits of the colony outweigh the costs, as long as relatedness remains at an invariable 0.5. This period of time in evolutionary history is known as the monogamy window. Now, in addition to worker sterility, lifetime monogamy also selects for extraordinarily long lifespans. You'll probably know that the queens of these reproductive castes often live for many decades, but it does mean that when they do die, or if their sperm storage runs out, the colony will die with it, because there will be no one there to replenish the workers.
The whole colony will perish, because you need them both. Just like in an ant queen, if she would run out of stored sperm, that's the end of it.
And unlike facultative eusocial animals, there will be no individual that can take on the reproductive role after one has died, such as the case of the naked mole rats. Naked mole rats live in colonies, with one reproductive queen who produces the offspring, 1 to 3 males they mate with, and the workers, who are sterile and help maintain the nest and forage for food. However, the difference between naked mole rats and obligately eusocial animals is that when the queen naked mole rat dies, the most dominant worker becomes the new reproductive. Their castes are reversible. Now, I'm sure there'll be somewhere out there who'll say, by the way, Nace, you are aware that there are plenty of superorganisms out there that have a relatedness of way less than 0.5 and that have no form of lifetime monogamy? And indeed, you'd be absolutely right, there are plenty of examples. Honeybees, for instance, the queens actually mate with anything between 1 and 40 drones on the nuptial flight. And ants often have what are known as polygynous queens, which means that multiple queens found the nest. However, what I've been trying to explain in this video is that in order for the major evolutionary transition to happen where you end up with a superorganism and irreversibly differentiated castes, all you need is to have a period of time where you've gone through this period of lifetime monogamy and that relatedness settling at around 0.5. After that transition has happened, by nature, it is irreversible, so it's normal for secondary developments to happen. And to be honest, being able to mate with multiple individuals and have a higher genetic diversity is a great way of being robust to disease and environmental fluctuations.
Those colonies tend to be more robust against diseases. So they simply tackle challenges from infections more efficiently than colonies that are full siblings. And again, you can imagine, particularly in societies that become really big and long-lived, that that is a significant advantage.
On many levels, the evolution of superorganisms share many parallelisms with zygote development.
You can compare, say, the cells in my body in some ways with worker ants serving their colony. The only difference is that they're all fixed together in my body, whereas ant workers walk around doing their things. But they're very similar in their loyalty. So my skin cells and my brain cells and my stomach cells are all totally devoted to keeping me alive and as long as they possibly can. And that's exactly the same for ant workers. And When I thought about it, I realized that in fact the origin of a body, let's say my body or a horse or an elephant or a little mice, is very similar to a monogamous situation, because it's a single zygote, it's a lifetime commitment to an egg produced by my mother and a sperm produced by my father. And when they came together and fertilization took place, that was a lifetime commitment. That sperm could not have regretted the commitment and rather have fertilized another egg. Neither could that egg have thrown out that particular sperm because it didn't particularly like it and would have liked to have another one. So that is why I think the evolution of obligate multicellularity, things like animals, plants, some algae, and the higher fungi, actually we can explain these major transitions with very much the same simple logic of strict lifetime commitment at foundation.
I find it beautiful how the way superorganisms evolved is entirely analogous to all previous major evolutionary transitions, and this is actually a collaboration with Stated Clearly, so I urge you to learn more about over here in Stated Clearly's impeccably animated video on how the other major transitions of evolution happened. I also really want to thank Professor Boomsma I, who kindly agreed to be interviewed for this video. Now, the actual interview lasted over an hour in length. We chatted about lots of things about eusociality and the evolution of bees, and a month ago I asked people to send me questions on Twitter about the evolution of bees and eusociality, so I'll probably release that part of the interview where he's answering subscriber-submitted questions in that part. But as you may have twigged, this is one of my favourite areas in evolutionary biology, so if you have any questions on the topic, feel free to ask them down below, I will definitely answer, and who knows, I might even make a follow-up to this video. And as always, thank you so much for watching me, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye!